Invariably, there are occasions when you walk on the beach and you might ask, how do our coasts get the way they do? Today we'll look at tiny little flow features that give texture to our beaches and how they do it. Then we'll explore the forces that create deltas, and we'll see how humans try to control our coastline. Let's start with swash and backwash. Swash is really the water that flows from the ocean onto the land. It contains sand, sediment, and organic materials such as shells or bits of bones or scales. Backwash is the water that flows from the land back into the ocean, and it's controlled by beach slope and gravity. This water can also be fresh water from rivers or runoff. Now, backwash marks are the crescent-shaped marks that you often see in sand caused by water that's flowing back into the ocean. Quite often, you see a strong appearance of these features as water flows around shells, rocks, or even your feet. Backwash marks are created by water that flows around a barrier and scours the sand around it. The complex flows lift and sort lighter materials from the heavier ones, resulting in the V-shaped patterns that you see. And remember, the V's in the backwash marks always point to the mainland. We also see ripple marks, and these features resemble small sand dunes. The varieties depend on the strength and direction of the current, and we have a couple of kinds, symmetric and asymmetric. Symmetric ripples are caused by two currents like swash and backwash, or flows that alternate between two different directions. Asymmetric ripples are created by shallow current that flows in a single direction with the peaks of the dunes inclined in the direction of the current. Next, we see rills. These are meandering textures and braided flow features that we see on the surface of the beach. They usually run perpendicular to the shoreline and are more prominent on low slope beaches. And they're created when streams and drainage needs to find its outlet to the ocean. Deltas play a huge role in nurturing life on the low-energy coast. They act to preserve the coast, filter water, and provide an environment for young organisms to flourish. The shape of a delta is controlled by tides, wind, or rivers, or any combination of those elements. For deltas in windy environments, we tend to see a smooth and straight coastline as the wind seems to shave and remove any protruding features along the coast. Tides have their own signature on deltas and will act to encroach onto the land, leaving the deltas with a somewhat concave inland appearance. A river-controlled delta, on the other hand, extends the landmass into the ocean, particularly if a river is full of sediment, like the Mississippi, which is pushing its presence into the Gulf of Mexico. Other land features that are molded by these forces are atolls. An atoll is a circular chain of islands that develops on a coral reef surrounding a submerged volcano or seamount. As sand collects behind the reef, we're left with a circular chain of islands. Now, we don't usually find atolls on continental coasts, but rather in ocean environments. Let's touch on coastal management. Both humans and nature have ways to control or modify the coastline. There are two primary ways to do this, and this could be with hard structures or soft structures. The hard ones usually include something man-made, fixed, or rigid. They could be concrete, steel, or wooden structures, or even rock slides. So let's have a look at them. First, we have groins. A groin is a solid structure running perpendicular to the coast out into the ocean. Designed to reduce coastal erosion, it often results in an increase or decrease of beach area in some places. As the longshore current works its way around a groin toward the coast, it has enough velocity to dig into the coast and remove sand. As the current continues along the shoreline, it loses some of that speed and will tend to dump some of that sand at the foot of the next groin or barrier. So you can see how the beach will decrease or increase on either side of that groin. We also have breakwaters that are rock or concrete structures that run parallel to the coast, but offshore. These are designed to absorb some of the wave energy and provide protection for anchored boats and harbors. Sometimes the longshore current is able to move on both sides of that barrier. Since the mainland side of the barrier tends to be more shallow, the longshore current will be slower and will unload any material that it carries. And soon we'll see the beach is working its way toward the breakwater. Very similar to how tombolos work. Seawalls are another feature that aim to control erosion. This is essentially a barrier on the coast that is able to withstand the constant battering of waves and wind. They're usually made of concrete, rock infill, or steel structures. Coastal management is also achieved by adding sand or beach nourishment. This is often a short-term solution unless land is permanently reclaimed. That wraps up our session on how small forces in nature can influence the shape of our coasts as well as how man-made barriers aim to control it. I'm Mike Kozik, and this is Science Blast.